Good afternoon and welcome from beautiful Barcelona. My name is Raksha Daryanani and I'm the research and content manager at Hosco. And I'm really pleased that you've joined us today for this Cultivating a Wellbeing Strategy Across Three Levels panel discussion co-hosted by EHL in collaboration with Hosco. We are a professional network specially designed for the hospitality industry. Hosco was born in 2011 to empower industry by uniting all of its professionals, educational centers, and employers in one global network. Our network allows you to connect with other professionals, with the industry, find or provide job opportunities, find career advice, and access courses to upskill and reskill. We currently have 1.6 million hospitality students and professionals on Hosco. We also have more than 400 hospitality schools and 1,000 plus world-class companies around the globe. I will introduce the two experts that we have today who have extensive experience in the field of organizational behavior and leadership. First of all, Dr. Stefano Borzio, Associate Professor of Organizational Behavior at EHL. Please, could you introduce yourself?
Thanks. Thank you very much, Rashka. So my name is Stefano Borzillo. I've been working at EHL since almost 7 years now. My main field of interests are organizational behavior in large organizations, small and medium companies, public and private. Have some consulting experience as well. And I conduct research mainly in the field of organizational psychology and psychological safety and learning organizations and team well-being and team dynamics.
Thank you so much for that. And next we have Natalie Boudou, author, consultant, coach, and facilitator. Natalie works with executives, senior management, and leadership teams from a wide range of corporate and international organizations. Natalie, please, could you tell us a little bit more about yourself?
Yes. Hi. So I'm Natalie. I'm delighted to be here today. I'm the CEO of Humanforce. And we are a company whose mission it is to move the workforce to a human force. So we build resilient, emotionally intelligent cultures in organizations. And we work with a number of organizations to implement health and well-being strategies, working with the employees, working with teams and the organizations themselves to build caring cultures that foster performance.
Fantastic. Thank you so much for joining us today. We're really happy that you took the time to want to share your insights through panel discussion. And today's panel discussion is extra special because it happens to be World Mental Health Day. So yeah. I think it'll be extra beneficial for anyone who's joining. The 1 hour panel discussion today will help you understand what causes burnout and it'll give you practical strategies to prevent burnout in the workplace and manage teams in a fast-paced industry like ours. It will also teach you how to bring psychological safety into your workplace and teams for enhanced performance and increased resilience. And last but not least, you'll learn how to convey a culture of workplace well-being. So without further ado, let's get started. I'll also brief you on how we're going to go about this. First, we will have a short presentation by Natalie and Stefano, after which we will proceed with the panel discussion. And then you'll have a chance as the audience to ask your questions. So in the meantime, please keep popping them in the chat box as they occur to you, and we will definitely answer them at the end. And we hope you enjoy. So over to you, Natalie.
Yes, thank you. So I'm going to now share my screen with you. Hopefully that everybody can see that. Hopefully that's okay. So I'm just going to also move my, I wonder if I can move myself here because when I share my screen, I don't think I'm in the, oh well. Okay, so looking at the PowerPoint presentation here, we're starting off with a slide, which is really talking about the importance of health and well-being today in or for organizations. And clearly, when we talk about health and well-being, first of all, we're talking about mental health, we're talking about physical health, but we're also talking about well-being in the environment. So the environment within which a person works, whether it's a safe environment, whether it's also a caring environment, and it enables health to come out. So we're talking about all of those aspects. And what you can see here on the screen are some quite interesting statistics. You can see there that the pandemic, the recent pandemic, has certainly had an impact on health and well-being. Before the pandemic, this topic was certainly coming to the forefront. But I think if anything, the pandemic has given it even a bigger push 78% of employees there saying the pandemic has negatively affected their mental health. Clearly, it was a huge, huge deal in terms of health and well-being during the pandemic. I know that we were working really hard to support teams and to support managers. And since the pandemic, things have not necessarily got any easier. There are still a lot of challenges out there. What we know is that employees are now thinking and expecting different things from their organizations. They are expecting the organizations to take care, to look after them, particularly in the wake of the pandemic. And there are still many challenges that are out there. So for example, we can look at the long hours. People are working longer hours. That's what research is showing. And of course, that's not being helped by hybrid or remote work, where people are being connected or are staying connected to their workplaces, sometimes well beyond the normal hours of work. Excessive workloads, I'm sure that this is going to be a problem for every organization. I certainly see it. People seem to be having to do more, and often to do more with fewer resources. So that's not easy either. We also see that there are increased job insecurities. So more and more people are working under short-term contracts. They're working perhaps in a freelance capacity without the employer support, and that often puts pressure on their mental health. There are rising attrition rates. People are leaving companies more than before, and certainly that is being seen amongst top talent. So that's another reason, and we often know that these attrition rates are very often due to mental health. And also the skills for employees, the new technology is great, of course it's great, but it also comes with its challenges. And we've talked just briefly there about the fact that people are finding it difficult to switch off from work. In fact, there's a new term which is called leavism, and it's really about how people find it difficult to leave their work, even late at night or sometimes early in the morning or over the weekend. And so this constant change and this uncertainty is adding pressure and impacting the health of people. And I think also there's something that's important to remember is that we're now looking at the younger generations coming into the workplace, and they have different expectations from some of the older generations. They want to know that their health is valued, and they will choose an employer for that reason. And so in terms of attracting talent and retaining talent, it's important to cater for those audiences as well. And of course, needless to say, it's the right thing to do. So that's just an introduction to the situation that we're facing. And I think I'm going to hand over now to Stefano. Stefano, you're going to talk a little bit more about the hospitality industry.
Yeah, thanks. Thank you very much, Natalie. So I will add on a little bit of information and some statistics specifically related to the burnout in the hospitality industry. So it's important to bear in mind that these numbers have been increasing actually since the pandemic and the end of the pandemic. You see statistics here on the screen, but like important to notice that 62% of employees in general, in a broader aspect of the hospitality sector, perceive that actually the employer does not actually take care of their working conditions or health conditions or workloads. You've got this also alarming figure of 74%, which experience verbal abuse from a customer in the workplace. You also have verbal abuse sometimes also from colleagues, but the 74% is quite shocking actually when it comes from customers. And this is quite a big topic now that's emerging in the press, in research, increasingly also. You also have 24% of employees active in this sector who actually complain that there's an increased required for medical or psychological help, for actually mental help, which has been increased even more by loneliness and all of the effects of the COVID pandemic. And 10% of the people of the staff have received or are receiving training to support health and well-being within the organization, that goes like, for example, accessing mentoring programs, having health champions in organizations and first help aiders, 10% is not enough. So we are seeing some companies who are actually investing more money in actually well-being for their employees, for their workforce at different levels of the organization. So although the pandemic has been extremely, let's say, bad in this respect, if I can call it, the good news is that it has raised the awareness on the fact that companies need increasingly to invest resources into these individual team and collective well-being aspects.
Great. Thank you, Stefano. So yes, I mean, it's they are quite shocking figures. And what we're going to look at now is a three-tiered approach. So it's really important to, when you're looking at health and well-being and to make it successful for your organization, is to think about it as a systemic approach. And we look there at the employee, the team level, and also the organizational level. It's not enough. It's not enough to just offer the latest app or to put in place a gym at your workplace, or even to just offer trainings for your employees. That is nice. These are nice gestures and they're important gestures, but it's not going to be enough. You will be missing an important piece of the puzzle if you don't have the other part, which is actually looking at the organization and the environment within which the employees are working. We really have to look at the world or the system that we inhabit. And so the second tier here, leadership and teams, leaders have a huge part to play in the reduction of stress and burnout. They are role models, they have some impact, and they do need to be equipped actually with the skills to be able to support their team members, and also to build teams that are empathetic, teams that are working well together, safe teams, which we're going to talk about in a minute. And then lastly, of course, you've got the organization itself. And what we know from research and lots of different surveys is that there are a number of organizational factors that will impact the health and well-being of an organization. And these range from things like workload, psychological safety, support, communication, and recognition, just to name a few. And it's very important that when an organization is looking at their health and well-being, they're also considering these aspects to make sure that the environment is a safe one. So that's one of the things that we talk about a lot, is this need to have a really systemic approach. And the companies that do that have the most successful initiatives. So what we're also looking at here, ideally, is we're looking at having a strategic approach. So when we go into an organization who want to build a caring environment, who want to improve their health and well-being, the best approach is not to treat health and well-being as a standalone subject, as just something that stands on its own, but to see it as a subject that crosses over and touches into all aspects of the organization. For example, health and well-being sometimes does sit within diversity and inclusion. Certain underrepresented minorities and certain populations will have more challenges on their mental health. And so this becomes immediately a diversity and inclusion question. And likewise, including the subject of health and well-being and removing the stigma and making it inclusive, having an inclusive approach to health and well-being, is also a diversity and inclusion subject. So you can see already how it crosses over into diversity and inclusion. It will also cross over into your ESG, your environmental, social and governance departments. And of course, it will impact other departments such as leadership as well. So the people who need to take responsibility, ideally, are the people at the top of the company. And you'll see here on this slide, I've given an example of the way in which we go in.
Natalie, sorry to interrupt you, but we don't see your screen anymore.
Oh, I'll stop sharing.
Yeah.
Okay. I'll try and share again.
Yes, please.
Thanks for letting me know.
We're getting feedback that, yes.
Okay. Do you see it now?
Yes, now we see it.
Great, super. Mm-hmm. So just giving you here an example of how we approach what is a strategic approach. First of all, there's a needs and assessment. So here we have a look at what's going on, what's working well for the company in terms of health and well-being, and where there might be need for change. And that can be done via assessments and interviews and discussions and data collection. And then we can put together a strategic program, which is going to be linked to the business rationale and to the performance objectives of the company. And then initiatives can be rolled out across the organization. Ideally, really what you want is you want, the best practice really is that the roadmap will have objectives shaped around organizational vision, plans on how the well-being is going to be promoted amongst the staff, and staff support for all of this. And training initiatives, obviously education is great for employees and for managers. And then towards the end of we have this measurement and review. It's extremely important to measure and to compare where you are with regards to where you were when you first collected all this information before you begin the process. So there's always this element of measuring and reviewing that carries on throughout the initiative to make sure that things are moving. So that's just to give you an overall, a bird's eye view of what a strategic approach looks like. And you may say to yourself, okay, this seems like a lot of work. Is it really worth it? Well, the costs of inaction are quite great, as you can see. We've put some figures up there. 12 billion working days are lost every year to mental health issues. That's quite huge. We've got $47.6 billion missed work is estimated to cost the economy. This was a 2022 Gallup survey. And you can see that actually a lot of employers are frightened about implementing health and wellbeing initiatives. They feel that it's going to actually lower the performance, but actually it's quite the opposite. Return on investment really is quite an important thing. And what we don't see there, what we actually don't see, which I think is really important to mention, is that you will also see that people will also have more sick leave when they are not engaged, when they are not happy, when they're not performing well. That sick leave, of course, is costly. There's health insurance to consider. And the other thing that we don't see is what happens when people come to work and they're not doing well. And we call that presenteeism, when they're coming to work and they're not doing well. And that is very costly to the organization. It's estimated at 3 to 4 times more costly than people who are absent or on sick leave. So a huge amount of reasons in terms of performance and productivity to think about the costs of burnout and poor health. And then here are some nice ideas and nice suggestions around the return on investment. You can see healthier and energized workforces, improved collaboration, performance, productivity, and talent attraction and talent retention. There have been a number of surveys done on return on investment to try and calculate what it is. It's difficult sometimes to see, but more and more chief financial officers are becoming involved and taking on this element as a strategic priority and are actually starting to evaluate what the risks are of not investing in this. A recent Deloitte study found that return on investment was what, $5 for every $1 spent on training and $6 for every $1 spent on awareness raising in the company. So these are some figures. I know that the World Health Organization also has some similar figures. And lastly, my last slide really is just, my last slide isn't there. I don't know why that is not there. Here we are, a business case for investment. So this is just to give you an idea of what it looks like when you do put this in place. Here is a business case where we were working with a large client in Switzerland who wanted to improve the ability of its people managers to care for their teams. They had increased absence rates. They had isolated cases of burnout, and they wanted to improve the staff morale as well. And you could see that a number of things were done. First of all, we did a needs assessment, as we showed in that previous slide. We collected the information, and with HR, we developed a roadmap, which was going to be rolled out over a period of 2 years to actually put in place all of these initiatives. And you can see there that there was a number of things done, including training, awareness raising, They had resilience weeks, HR was trained. So a lot of things were done. And the impact was an increased confidence from the managers in being able to spot their stress and support team members. A lot of exchange and best practices. The taboo of mental health was starting to be addressed and dismantled. And teams reported up to 15% decrease in sick leave and significant savings in health insurance costs. And lastly, huge increase in their engagement survey scores. So that just gives you an idea. Hopefully that introduction has been helpful. I'm going to stop sharing now and hand back over.
Fabulous. Thank you so much, Natalie and Stefano, for that wonderful introduction. Let's proceed to the questions I will ask you now. Okay, so I have some questions for you, Natalie, if we can start with you, if that's all right.
Okay, yeah, sure.
So you spoke a lot about burnout prevention and stress reduction. So how bad is stress for you? I mean, like, you know, I mean, everyone goes through stress. So on a scale of 1 to 10, how do we measure how bad it is?
And that's a good question. Well, a little stress is not bad, right? Stress is important because stress is, helps us to perform. It helps us to grow. It helps us to evolve, actually. Mm-hmm. So stress is really not a dangerous thing. When it becomes dangerous is when it's too high and when it goes on for too long. Mm-hmm. And then it becomes what we call chronic stress. Mm-hmm. And that's when it can become toxic. So what you really want to do is you want to find your sweet spot at work. Mm-hmm. You don't want to have not enough stress where there can be boredom and demotivation, mm-hmm. but you don't want to have too much where it can become toxic and start to impact your health. Mm-hmm. So there you go. So that's really how it is. And it's chronic stress, which goes on for too long, for too high, that can eventually lead to burnout.
Okay, fabulous. Now, you spoke about burnout.
Yes.
Stress is only one part of burnout. Maybe you could highlight exactly what burnout consists of.
Yeah. Well, burnout actually is kind of... it's difficult. It's difficult for people to understand what burnout is, and it's used a lot sometimes when it's not actually burnout. It's a term that we become very familiar with, but few of us actually really understand it. Mm-hmm. And sometimes it's difficult to know when one is just chronically stressed, mm-hmm. or when one is actually in what we call a burnout, which mm-hmm. is quite severe, quite lots of consequences. Mm-hmm. What we know from research now, and also the World Health Organization has helped to actually define burnout, mm-hmm. Is that burnout consists of three elements. This will help you to know that you might be in burnout. The first is a crushing feeling of exhaustion. Mm-hmm. So exhausting, actually. It's almost like the batteries have gone out. Mm-hmm. The second is feelings of alienation. You feel alienated from your environment. You feel mm-hmm. isolated. You mm-hmm. feel like you're not in connection with other people or the people around you. And the third is you feeling ineffective. Mm-hmm. So your worthiness, your self-worthiness is impacted. You don't feel like you're capable anymore. Mm-hmm. And it's when those three together are present that we are really in burnout. And sometimes you might have one, you might have two, but it's actually when those three are together that we really say that burnout is there. So, you know, of course, you've got all the other signs that chronic stress will give you. It will impact your mental abilities, your cognitive abilities. It will impact you physically. It will impact you emotionally, and it will impact your behavior. But those three directions that have been put in place really help us to understand burnout more clearly.
Okay, fabulous. Thank you for that. And so you've already touched upon sort of the three aspects. And do you see any warning signs that one can look out for when it comes to burnout in themselves or in a team member?
Absolutely. So really going back to those four areas that I talked about, the first is your body, mm-hmm. and your body does not lie. So obviously fatigue and tiredness is one of the first signs, not being able to fall asleep at night or waking up during the middle of the night. That's a clear sign that things are not going well. Other things will vary depending on the person. For some, it might be digestive problems. For others, it might be headaches, those kind of psychosomatic problems that sometimes you go to the doctor for and you're not too sure why. Things like eczema, perhaps. Those kind of things where your body will be telling you that stress is becoming a problem. The other area is the cognitive area. So maybe you're going to be less focused. you're going to be more distracted, your memory won't be the same, the concentration isn't so easy. Mm-hmm. And perhaps also you go into what we call tunnel vision, where you start to not be able to see the wood for the trees. Mm-hmm. Emotions will be more impacted. You might be experiencing more strong emotions of maybe hostility or aggressivity, mm-hmm. or maybe just despair and sadness. Mm-hmm. And then lastly, your behavior will change. We might see, for example, compensatory behavior. Some people will smoke more or drink more. Mm-hmm. Some people will withdraw. They will mm-hmm. become more isolated. Mm-hmm. So these are all signs that you can look out for.
Okay. Wow, that's really impactful, I would say.
And there's when you mentioned, actually, when Natalie mentioned the cognitive side, it will take us to psychological safety, bringing it to a different perspective, which is also very conducive, actually, to reduce the level of negative stress, mm-hmm. Taken from a different perspective, which mm-hmm. which I can talk about as long as we can move to it.
Oh, I would love to hear more. I'm all ears now. So now I'll come back to the psychological safety part. I have one last question for Natalie.
Yep.
Yes.
So what is the manager's role with regard to the well-being of their team? And what do you do if you sense someone on your team is highly stressed or is struggling at work? How do you notice? What should you notice, and what can you do?
These are big questions. Do you have a day?
I have all life. But we have some time.
Yeah. The manager has a crucial role to play. Mm-hmm. They are, the closest to their teams. Mm-hmm. Very often they think that it's HR's role, but actually no, the managers do have an important role. Mm-hmm. They are there to role model well-being for a start. If they mm-hmm. are sending emails at 3 o'clock in the morning, well, that's the message that they're giving to their team, that it's okay to do that. Mm-hmm. So that's really very important. The mm-hmm. manager is going to set the tone, basically, their behaviors, the way in which they behave. If they are empathetic, if they are kind, if they are caring, mm-hmm. Then that's going to set the tone for the whole of the team. They can also, in some instances, have an impact on the way in which work is distributed, help to ensure that resources are available, and maybe ensure that their team is trained as well if necessary. Mm-hmm. And lastly, the caring conversations. This is the huge thing that we train managers on. We go into the workplace and we train managers on how to have a caring conversation. Mm-hmm. If you think somebody is stressed, if you mm-hmm. spot a warning sign, mm-hmm. you do have a role to play as a manager, mm-hmm. to actually try and understand what's going on. Mm-hmm. You're not going in as a therapist. You're going in simply as a manager to understand, to get curious, and mm-hmm. to see and assess the situation. And the quicker you do that, the more likely it is that you can avoid long-term leave. So it's very important.
Mm-hmm. And I gather that might not be very comfortable for everybody. So is that the reason you provide that training?
Yes, because it's not easy, because it requires emotional intelligence, obviously, mm-hmm. certain skills, mm-hmm. certain way, certain approach. And most managers do feel uncomfortable with it, mm-hmm. Which is understandable because they are difficult conversations. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Okay, wow. I want to learn more, but I will give some more attention to some psychological safety, because I think the audience would like to learn some more about that. So Stefano, over to you. Thank you so much, Natalie, for enlightening us. I'll get back to you in a bit. So you mentioned psychological safety. Can you tell me more about this term and how it gained importance in the workplace? So what actually falls under psychological safety?
Yeah, I mentioned psychological safety at the moment where Natalie actually mentioned the word cognitive. I could not resist the temptation of, seizing the opportunity. Mm-hmm. This is fantastic because it's actually viewing the problem from a different perspective. So I'm coming from a more like learning organizational perspective. Mm-hmm. And I think it's complementary to what Natalie said. So if you talk about psychological safety, it's actually a shared belief. Mm-hmm. It's a shared organizational belief, like a paradigm. It's the feeling that people have that it's safe, it's okay to speak up mm-hmm. in a team, mm-hmm. to express your concerns, to talk about the experiments that you set up, even share your failures and your calculated risks. Okay? It's a feeling, it's a belief that you have in a team that it's okay to ask questions, without the fear that there would be any negative consequences that you would experiment, mm-hmm. With your manager and so forth. Mm-hmm. So the point and the bridge that I'm building with what Natalie said is that psychological safety releases the level or contributes to release the level of negative stress. Mm-hmm. Of course, maintaining a level of positive stress, because very rare are the organizations where there is not a level of little fear. This mm-hmm. is what boosts you to come up with new ideas, right? Mm-hmm. So it helps, psychological health safety helps you find this fine balance mm-hmm. and reduces the amount of negative stress in the team. Mm-hmm. So this is point A. Point B, it's really shifting, and this is what is important, the perspective to a learning and to productive learning. So what you're doing, you're shifting the perspective to learning. So you're seeing a problem, a failure sometimes, an experiment, from a complex problem perspective. So what you're doing, you're stepping back, you're having a helicopter view, and you're analyzing a complex problem by decomposing it into the sum of its parts. Mm-hmm. And this enables you the following in this mental frame, mm-hmm. to consider a failure that happened by focusing on different components of the problem. So you're shifting the who, the blame, the person, to the what, mm-hmm. going from who did it, and often it's not only one person, it's the result of interactions between several people in a complex problem, to what actually happened. So you're shifting it to the thing, to the concrete actions that happen. And I think this not only enables you to improve or to make corrective actions, it takes away the level of, you know, blaming culture that can often result in a lack of psychological safety. And last but not least, the C point I wanted to raise, the third little piece of nugget I wanted to share with you, is that psychological safety is, in fact, a prerequisite of team well-being. Mm-hmm. So what Natalie has generously shared with us in terms mm-hmm. of team well-being and so forth goes hand in hand with psychological safety. Mm-hmm. Okay. Mm-hmm. Psychological safety, you cannot sell it to your managers if you don't approach the topic with productive learning and therefore related to performance. Because at the end of the day, mm-hmm. if you're correcting a mistake, it's either an SOP, a standardized mm-hmm. operating procedure, mm-hmm. or it's also something like a prototype, something super innovative and experimental. Mm-hmm. But in both cases, to advance and to be performing for the organization, psychological safety has to exist.
Okay. Thank you so much for elaborating on that. So here's a question that goes a little bit deeper. You said you have to feel safe, but then I think psychological safety goes further than just having the trust to say, I made a mistake, correct?
Yeah, indeed. So this brings us to the distinction that we can make between trust in mm-hmm. general and psychological safety. Mm-hmm. They actually also go hand in hand. Now, mm-hmm. trust, if you consider trust, mm-hmm. it's a very broad concept, right? Mm-hmm. Trust encompasses like a belief or a confidence in someone's reliability, mm-hmm. integrity, and competence brought to an organizational level. Mm-hmm. Now, trust also involves the expectation that a person or an entity, like an organization, mm-hmm. will act in a predictable and dependable way. But this is like super general, okay? Mm-hmm. Now, if you bring it to a more nitty-gritty, if I may say, level, to mm-hmm. the level of the team, this is where you find psychological safety. So psychological safety is a specific aspect of trust that pertains to the workplace environment and interactions among team members, okay? So it's in a more controlled environment, if you want. And it boils down to what I was telling you before. It's speaking up in case, you know, you disagree, the ability to taking calculated risks, making failures to a certain extent, within certain boundaries. Okay, I'm not advocating for errors and mistakes. I'm saying it's okay to fail once. If you fail a second time, then it's just a deviation from a proven practice, which is not recommended. Okay. So this is, you know, psychological safety can exist in a team, even if the level of trust in the broader organization is low. So said differently, if the level of trust or the culture in the organization is not, you know, of complete caring, you can still cultivate as a manager a level of psychological safety within your team, within your nest.
So basically, you have a subculture of trust, of psychological safety within a bigger atmosphere, which may or may not be functioning well. Is that
precisely
what you're saying?
Precisely. Okay. It's like a safety net. It's like a handy safety net to have. It mm-hmm. depends on the skill, the ability of the leader, the manager, but mm-hmm. also the collaboration of the team members, obviously.
Mm-hmm. But so which brings me to a question. Then it actually highlights even more the manager's role, because whether or not everything else is working well, you still have that core responsibility for your team, and you still can create that environment for them.
Yeah, I think absolutely. I think you hit the nail on its head. Absolutely. So it's a shared responsibility. In fact, when I work with organizations and you discuss different cases, you realize that the number of organizations which have full psychological safety are in fact very, very rare. So when you bring it to the level of the team, yes, it's the responsibility of the leader to model his or her behavior, be approachable, show fallibility also, a form of vulnerability, which doesn't mean you're incompetent, it just means you're approachable, okay? And also, setting limits. This is important. As counterintuitive as it may sound, you need to set limits, boundaries, for people to feel psychologically safe. If you don't have a frame where you explain to people, okay, this is what you can do, and beyond that, it's a mistake, then, you know, it's chaos, and this creates even more insecurity. So it's a very fine line that you need to respect here. Now, when I talk about team members, well, their responsibility in playing this game, in playing this good citizenship as team members, is to avoid all form of judgment when you brainstorm, for example, you fish for ideas, and to intervene when necessary. What do I mean? If a team member, if you're a good team citizen and you witness a team which interrupts constantly, makes judgments, and has some kind of a, you know, deviant behavior, it's necessary to, I mean, in the first time, to have a conversation with the person and simply not acknowledge also this behavior and to report it, you know, first in a, let's say, in a an informal way. And then if it becomes more constant, then it becomes more of an HR problem.
So if I understand correctly, you're saying we have like a duty of care towards each other as employees in a team, not just the manager's responsibility to make sure we are feeling psychologically safe, but also for each other, correct?
Absolutely. And I mean, this has always prevailed and more, like we have even more like variables, societal variables that adds, you know, diversity, inclusion. We have more and more polarization, you know, in our society. Mm-hmm. And these are realities, social realities that companies have to absolutely take into account in the way they manage people. Mm-hmm. Because it's also a part actually of psychological safety, this inclusion and diversity in a team.
Okay, fabulous. Thank you so much for that. And this is a question for both of you, because it touches upon both aspects. So the stress part, the burnout part, and also the psychological safety part. How do working hours and workload affect these dynamics in the workplace? And what do you have to say about that? Like, so, you know, psychological safety, does it increase, decrease, or and stress, how does it increase, decrease with when there's mounting pressure?
Shall I go first, Stefano?
Yeah, please.
Yeah.
Please.
So, I mean, certainly, you know, it's quite obvious that long working hours are not going to be helpful. You know, we're human beings. You've probably noticed that a number of companies recently have tried out this 4-day working week. I think Belgium, Iceland, and the UK in particular have had these trials where companies have tried out a 4-day working week. And over a period of a few months, they've already reported increased, improved results in terms of mental health and well-being across their staff, to the point where they're actually keeping it on. It was a trial, but they're keeping it on. So research shows that long hours do impact our mental health. And obviously, the hybrid remote way of working is going to be tricky in this area. And I think leaders have a responsibility to role model and ensure that their staff are not working outside of hours and on a regular basis. So in terms of hours, yes, there's definitely impact. In terms of workload, this is a tricky subject because this is something that all organizations are experiencing at the moment. But I think that there is a duty again on leadership to be reviewing strategies and ways in which they can lighten the workload, whether it's through prioritization or whether it's through assignment of tasks or job sharing or whatever it is. There needs to be some kind of review as to how this can work. It's more of an operational matter, but it's something that's very important.
And also, I think, I mean, if I go back to the field of the learning perspective, I think we can be efficient and work faster. I mean, digest a larger amount of work just by knowledge sharing. And what I mean is that when you work, either you have the workload completely on your shoulders, or you have a system in place that enables you to share information, good practices with other colleagues. So you save time. So what you have here, you can incorporate a lot of visualization in your work. So after a project, for example, you could have focused event analysis or after action reviews, which enable you to rapidly mobilize a group of people and talk about what happened and gain fast learning on it, document it so the error doesn't repeat itself afterwards. Okay, so it doesn't take too long to do an after action review, but it's very beneficial because you get to talk to other people, you get solutions rapidly, you learn fast, it's a learning organization, and it reduces an amount of stress. Okay, and you share the amount of work and thinking process amongst people. And then you have also something, I think it's also another safe zone, it's what we call communities of practice, which are informal networks that you find in companies, which are actually cross teams. So you can belong, you can have a community, which is a network. Very often today, they are hosted digitally. And people, it's a group of individuals who are all interested in a specific topic. It can be marketing practices, finance, operational, you name it. They gather together on an informal basis and they exchange the problems, the frustrations they have, the stress they have, and they gain insight and support and mental support sometimes from each other. And sometimes just by sharing a good practice, a best practice across a team, across a division, or across even a division in different countries, also takes away part of the reflection process you need to do to accomplish a task. So it's not a miracle that these communities of practice are safe zones that can actually help you get practices that are somewhere in the organization. And it kind of reduces, in certain circumstances, the amount of work that you can have.
Fabulous. Thank you for that. I think that multi-pronged approach is really helpful for our audience to understand.
Yeah.
And then I'll ask you one last question before we take a question from the audience. So what can leaders do to support health and well-being in hybrid teams, considering one has limited information on an employee's state of well-being if they're working remotely or in a hybrid form?
Yeah. Okay. So I could maybe take this one and then Natalie, yes, you can complete. So yeah, virtual working is a different ballgame, right? Mm-hmm. We are bi-dimensional in virtual space. Sometimes we have never met the people. Mm-hmm. You don't get to understand the mimics and the nonverbal communication sometimes, the technology, mm-hmm, the bandwidth. Okay, this is one level. The second level, what helps? There are four things I would say that help. Mm-hmm. Create safety. Anonymous polls, mm-hmm, okay? So asking people if they agree to on a scale of 1 to 5, for example, anonymously. Mm-hmm. So this, you know, is a way of expressing concern about something without taking too much risk. Breaking rooms are a good way, actually. Sometimes online meetings are good. So simply sometimes breaking the meeting into small breakout rooms, giving the opportunity to a small group of people to interact, to exchange, is a safer zone, right? Okay. That creates more well-being, less stress. And then when you come back to the larger meeting, mm-hmm, you feel more comfortable because you're more knowledgeable thanks to all of the exchanges you had. Okay. Right. It also helps, I think, to have an experienced facilitator sometimes, mm-hmm, in online meetings, mm-hmm, because they know by experience how to orchestrate the talk. And this unconsciously gives dynamics, but also a sense of confidence and comfort to the people who participate. And then I would say the follow-up meeting, the follow-up email summarizing the critical points without naming people who ask questions, but simply actions that were spoken about, I think it just shows that, the company cares and is actually caring about the follow-up that we have after these virtual meetings.
Okay, fabulous. So if it's okay with both of you, I'll go over to the audience questions because we have a lot of questions pending. Is that all right?
Yep, sure.
Yeah.
Okay, okay. So the first question that we have is, how can feedback mechanisms be integrated into well-being initiatives to ensure that they remain relevant and effective for all individuals in the hospitality industry?
Could you repeat the question, Roshka?
Yes.
Quite a long one.
Yeah, it's quite a long one. So how can feedback mechanisms be integrated into the well-being initiatives so that it's relevant for the whole industry?
Stefano, help me out on this question because what I'm hearing is, how can feedback be done in a caring way? So is that the gist of the question?
As part of a well-being initiative. So you've implemented a well-being initiative, and
I think it can be brought. I'm going to start, Natalie, maybe with the big picture, and then you can. I think we can bring it to a systemic level. So there are different parties here involved necessarily. You will have management, or let's say higher management. I don't even want to talk about top management because sometimes they don't have time. Let's say, higher management. Mm-hmm. You need to have a sponsor, from higher management, which is, involved in the follow-up and what's going on in terms of well-being in general in the company. Mm-hmm. Okay, so this sends off a strong signal. You can call him, her, chief well-being officer, you name it. Mm-hmm. You need to have necessarily collaboration from your human resource department or people department, you call it, okay? Mm-hmm. Because higher management and human resource management, they need to be aligned, because if there's a problem mm-hmm. related to health and well-being, necessarily HR will be at some point consulted. Consulted, okay, whether through mediation or taking corrective actions. And then what you need to have, ideally, a system in place whereby you have a team. It can be 4, 5, 6 people, pilot group sometimes, mm-hmm. or a group of involved collaborators who actually, their mission is to collect all of the feedback that they give. Okay. It's like a thinking tank. And talking about what can be done, the different practices, and often it's multidisciplinary teams. Mm-hmm. So they all come with a different perspective mm-hmm. and their own take on what's going on. And so it's very important to liaise between this pilot group, this group mm-hmm. of people, multidisciplinary team, mm-hmm. HR, and this well-being champion. And okay. I think without this magical triangle, it's difficult actually to do something productive out of this feedback, right? So okay. again, I'm bringing it into the learning organization perspective.
Yeah, I think I would just add one level to that, Stefano. I think that also it can be useful for the leaders, the managers of their teams, to be checking in with their teams, to be getting feedback on how any ongoing work or initiatives are impacting them, because they can feedback from the ground level almost how this is impacting the workforce as a whole. So I think that's useful to have continuous checks and continuous assessments to understand what's happening at all levels as well. But I think that's an important part too.
Okay, thank you for adding that. We have one more question. Someone asked, should we prioritize reducing stress coming from the environment, or should we prioritize reducing stress coming from pure work challenges?
Well, I mean, I don't think you can prioritize stress from one area or another. I mean, you're going to have stress that's coming from the environment. As I said, it's a systemic approach. You've got stress coming from the job itself. Everybody's going to find that their job is difficult at some point, or maybe they're not going to have enough resources, or perhaps they're not going to have clarity on what they're supposed to be delivering, or maybe the roles and responsibilities are not clear. So there's stress from the job itself. But at the same time, the environment is just as important. If we don't have what Stefano was talking about, if we don't have psychological safety, if we don't have an environment that is caring and compassionate, then obviously that's also going to impact the individual. So I think we have to really, as I said right at the beginning, we have to have a systemic approach. We have to look at all the triggers, all the root causes of stress, mm-hmm. and ensure that we are addressing them.
Okay. Someone has asked, and I think this is a nice extension to this question.
Yeah.
This is not only for employees, but managers also face stress. So this counts for them as well, right?
Absolutely. And one of the first rules that we say is to be a good manager, you must have self-care. So to be able to work with your team and to support them, you have to put the oxygen mask first on yourself. If I can use that metaphor, to be able to support your team in the right way. So it's very important that managers look after themselves. Yes.
Okay, fabulous. And someone is asking, I think this is probably, someone probably who wants to work on improving their workplace. So what tips do you have for moving forward toward a 4-day work week or decreasing the need for staff working outside of their normal working hours? A common issue I have run into when proposing better working environments is associated with this is that it will lead to increased staffing and therefore labor costs.
Stefano, do you want to take that one? It's more of an organizational question.
Yeah, of course. So I think that, the question perfectly makes sense because at the end of the day, I mean, there is a certain amount of work that needs to be completed in an organization, and there's a certain amount of employees, right? So sometimes if there's a huge quantity of work, you just need 5 days to do it. Now, sometimes it's a problem of productivity, okay? It's a problem of productivity because people are not able to fulfill all of the tasks they have to do in the allocated amount of time that they have. Mm-hmm. Sometimes it's simply a question of organization, right? Sometimes there are some redundancies mm-hmm. within the organizations. You're doing things that another colleague is probably doing the same thing at the same time.
Yeah.
So, it's one of those tricky questions. I mean, there are some cases in which it's possible, to condense for certain employees, okay, not all of them, for certain employees to have a lighter working schedule mm-hmm. if, they can do a bit of job sharing with mm-hmm. other people in the company.
Mm-hmm.
And you will most often find people who are willing to stay 5 days a week mm-hmm. and another portion of the company who wants to work 4 days a week.
Mm-hmm.
So maybe an intermediary and smart solution is probably to try and find combinations whereby mm-hmm. people who want to work 4 days a week mm-hmm. can shift a bit of their workload on different people who are working on the 5 week. And then, there's also, but there needs to be some form of compensation, I would say, mm-hmm. at the end of the tunnel for these people who are willing to give this helping hand.
Mm-hmm.
It's having everybody work 4 days, I mean, only 4 days, and the fifth day, doing nothing, I think it's a bit difficult. A hybrid possibility is a bit better, maybe if you provide more leeway, a bit more flexibility and liberty, and saying, okay, it's fine to have 1 day where you can work from home and, just be, on call in case we need you. It's kind of a in-between solution. But when there's a fixed amount of work and you have people, everybody wants to work 4 days, it's not possible. Then you have to find the compromises with colleagues who are willing to take a bit more. And then maybe at some point, there's a shifting. Somebody who works 5 days, who will have for 1 month taken a lot of work from a colleague who works 4 days,
mm-hmm.
then you give it back to one colleague who's working 4 days, and that person will work 5 days for once. So,
fabulous. Okay,
yeah,
so
it's not
a bit of a tricky balance there.
It's a bit of a tricky balance. I mean, and it varies by industry, it varies by company, it varies by size of the company, mm-hmm. and at what stage of development the company is. So it's a...
Okay, well, thank you for that. I think that gives a varied perspective and something to consider or mm-hmm. Balanced. And I am going to give you one last question, which is actually two questions in one, because we're almost out of time. How can an employee handle burnout in a cruise ship? Because it's not the same as working on land. It is working almost every day without an off day. And then someone else has asked, a lot of people are in the situation, which is a similar question, where they cannot afford to escape the stressful and toxic environment of a job. So how do you manage to keep your creativity sustained and intact? And how can you continue?
That's interesting. That's a very interesting one, isn't it?
I think what's really
important about, one of the very important ways to reduce stress and avoid burnout is what we call to find some time to recharge. I mean, mm-hmm. recharge and recovery is very important. And what you're talking about in a cruise ship is it's very difficult to escape. And you'll need to find moments. You'll need to build in moments during the day mm-hmm. when you are in almost what I call a mindful moment, where you can actually be away from all distractions, where you can reconnect to yourself and recharge. It may just be 2 or 3 minutes or 5 minutes at a time, but you need to build in some kind of recovery mechanism for yourself mm-hmm. where you are with yourself and where you're able to literally come out of your head and recharge. And there you might be doing certain exercises, maybe it's breathing exercises or something like that, but you need to have that space. You need to find that space within the context, which isn't simple. So I think that's, for me, that's one of the first things that came to mind when I was listening to you, is to have space for yourself, to have those moments when you can just literally relax, even if it's, and to do it several times during the day.
And mm-hmm. I think I can take the question on the toxic environment. So, I mean, in many cases, in fact, if you work in a toxic environment or you work, for a toxic person and so forth, oftentimes there's no very satisfying way out. So most people end up, looking for another job and leaving. But the bad news is that you can't leave immediately. So there are coping mechanisms or survival mechanisms you might want to do first. And one of them is building your internal network within the company. So you can assume that if you're working in a toxic team or for somebody who has like deviant behaviors, maybe that person, has already started maybe, stabbing you in the back or saying bad things about you to other colleagues or to his or her boss. So in this case, what is important in building your internal network might be approaching, your boss's boss, if you have this possibility, not necessarily to complain about the situation, not at all, just to talk, about the projects that you're doing, your expertise, your fields of expertise, your ambitions, and what you're doing in the company. Maybe this helps. It's a preventive measure, just to try and, re-embellish, if I may call it like this, your image and your aura that you have in the company, right? Because mm-hmm. it might have been dirtied by somebody you work for. Mm-hmm. Another possibility is reaching out to your formal line manager. You never know, they might have a project, you can be working for and, join the team. Sometimes if you're lucky, it can happen. Another possibility, is to, when options are kind of inexistent in the company, is try to, join as many hospitality events in the region where you live to try and network, as simple as that. Seek medical advice if you need it externally. But I mean, the bad news here is that, very often, people resign and sometimes it's okay just to let go and to go and work if you find the possibility in another division or even different company. Because what matters at the end of the day is your possibility to grow and your health, above all. So you can survive for a moment. You can try and build your internal, solidify your internal network. But hey, at the end of the day, I mean, if you're not supported neither by HR nor by other colleagues because the culture is too toxic, the best thing often is just to leave.
Fantastic. I think this has been super, super insightful for myself and I think for the audience too. We're getting good feedback. So I want to thank you, Natalie, Stefano, for taking your time today, for sharing the insights with us. It has been marvelous having you here. And for the audience, thank you so much for joining us as well. I hope you have learned. I hope you have walked away with the tangible insights that you were looking for. And this is just a little glimpse of EHL's transformational learning and business solutions and how EHL's expertise can help you develop people, address business challenges, and transform business practices. And for those who are looking to study, I see some people saying we want to study at EHL, then this gives you an idea of how they teach as well. So I hope you definitely get through with your admission. And I would like to thank you all for coming again. And if you want to watch the replay, don't worry, it'll be in your inbox within about a week's time. And if you have missed it for any chance or you want to, share it, please feel free to. And thank you so much again, both of you and the audience. And we hope to see you next time again with a partnered panel discussion. Have a lovely rest of the day.
Thank you
so much. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Bye-bye.